So moving again, in our tubular interstitial disease process, we're going to be talking and focusing on acute tubular obstruction. When our patients have acute tubular obstruction, it's essentially precipitation of substances in the tubules. And there's a couple of different categories that we really need to think about. We can have protein from immunoglobulins. This would be the case of CAS nephropathy, which we'll talk about in a minute. This can be urate, as in tumor lysis syndrome, just like our patient had. We can have calcium phosphate precipitated in the tubules, and that oftentimes can occur after receiving a phosphorus-containing enema or laxative. And finally, giving medications can cause intratubular crystal precipitation. What's important is that when patients develop this tubular obstruction, it almost always occurs in the setting of volume depletion and acidic urine. So let's go over our first situation. Our patient might develop acute tubular obstruction from having CAS nephropathy. This is going to typically occur when patients have plasma cell dyscrasia or malignancies, like multiple myeloma. Remember, in multiple myeloma, our patients essentially have an overproduction of immunoglobulin light chains, right, that are monoclonally restricted. And so they're produced in such a quantity that it burdens the kidney. The kidney normally can reabsorb those immunoglobulins in the proximal tubule, but there's so much and there's such an incredible amount that it actually starts to glob up those tubules. And again, combining that with a TAM horse wall protein then causes that to essentially obstruct that outflow of urine. We can also see acute tubular obstruction with tumor lysis syndrome, just like our patient had. So this can occur following chemotherapy or if somebody has a very, very high-grade tumor. And we can also see in this situation that that tumor essentially liquefies. We see this intracellular release of uric acid, phosphate, and potassium. And that's what is most indicative in our patient population. Phosphorus-containing enemas are also a problem, and that actually wasn't discovered until really probably around the early part of the century, around 2002. So this includes a bowel prep for colonoscopy. So where we used to see this scenario is that our patients would be undergoing potentially a sigmoidoscopy, and our gastroenterology colleagues might be giving something like a sodium phosphorus enema or laxative. And in that setting of volume depletion, they can precipitate calcium phosphorus in their tubules and interstitium. Again, you can see that when that deposits, it's associated with interstitial inflammation. The highest risk is in our patients with underlying chronic kidney disease. And this is a very significant situation. Again, you have to be a good detective, but we have transplanted patients over this situation. So it's very important to be cognizant of these phosphorus-containing enemas. Medications are also important. And again, this is being a good detective in understanding what your patients are getting, but we can see this with intravenous acyclovir. So a patient perhaps who's coming in with HSV encephalitis, with intravenous methotrexate, which we use in our chemotherapy armamentarium, and things like sulfonamide antibiotics. So how do we diagnose our patients and how do we work them up in order to clinch that diagnosis? Once again, as we've been talking about, we're going to be good detectives and we're really going to scour that chart and really take a very good history on our patients. Sometimes it's relatively easier if we know that our patient perhaps has a history already of multiple myeloma. We might be thinking about precipitation of those immunoglobulin light chains causing CAS nephropathy. If our patient has a known malignancy and they recently had chemotherapy administered, then we think about things like tumor lysis syndrome. Have our patients recently used a fleet enema or an oral sodium phosphorus laxative? That's also very important. And what I really want you to focus on as well is that that really does take good detective qualities. So remember patients who are coming in perhaps from a skilled nursing facility. It's not uncommon for nursing facilities to automatically place enemas on their patients in order to keep from constipation and having issues like that. And in that situation, those patients absolutely can be administered a fleet enema or a sodium phosphorus enema or laxative that can precipitate this phenomena. So not just looking at their current medications that they're receiving in the hospital, but really being that good detective and talking to the nursing facility or other sources where the patient may receive this type of medication. And then you want to do a thorough medication review. So looking at that medication administration record, the MAR, have our patients received IV acyclovir? Again, coming in with HSV encephalitis, that would be a common scenario where we'd see this happen. Do they have IV methotrexate for a malignancy or sulfonamide antibiotics? Laboratory evaluation can also be very helpful in our diagnostic workup in clinching that diagnosis. So for CAS nephropathy, what we're really looking for are those elevated free immunoglobulin light chains in the serum. So specifically, we may want to order a serum protein electrophoresis, or SPEP, with serum immunofixation. We also can look at serum-free light chains. And if these are elevated, this can really lead us to that diagnosis that perhaps CAS nephropathy is what's causing this acute tubular obstruction. For tumor lysis syndrome, we're going to see things like high uric acid, high phosphorus, high potassium levels, just as in the case of our patient at the beginning. For phosphate nephropathy, we tend to see very high phosphoruses and very low calciums. Why is that? Because remember what's happening. You have acute calcium phosphate deposition in those tubules. So for medications, what we oftentimes can do is we can look at our urinary sediment and we may see crystals from our precipitated medications that can really lead us to that diagnosis. So what can we do to treat our patients who have acute tubular obstruction? So in CAS nephropathy, remember what's happening. We have those immunoglobulin light chains that are precipitating. So we can actually administer chemotherapeutic agents like dexamethasone, proteasomal inhibitor-based regimens that are aimed at actually shutting down that immunoglobulin production. In cases of tumor lysis syndrome, we are really going to aim at preventing that from happening. So that means we're going to administer our chemotherapy with high amounts of isotonic fluids like saline and uric acid lowering agents like allopurinol or resveratrol to prevent or shut down production of uric acid so that doesn't obstruct the tubules. Acute phosphate nephropathy, unfortunately, when we give those phosphorus-containing enemas or laxatives, there's nothing that we can do after that situation other than offer supportive care. But certainly there's something that we can do at preventing that, and that's really just ensuring that our patients never receive these types of medications, particularly our patients who have underlying chronic kidney disease, because they are the ones that are so vulnerable to developing acute phosphate nephropathy. And finally, for medication-induced crystalline nephropathies, it's most important at the time that it's occurring to remove the offending drug. Now let's go back to that case again of that HSV encephalitis patient. A drug like acyclovir is critical for them in order to get better. So I can't keep that drug off completely, but what I can do is I can administer a lot of volume in the form of isotonic saline, and then again, retry that drug once that patient's volume status is optimized.